as mentioned, we're going to have lots of protons accumulating into membrane space. We're going to have an electrical gradient. We have a lot of positive charge on the one side and a relatively negative charge on the mitochondrial matrix, and those hydrogen ions are then going to want to follow the gradient in order to equalize the charge on either side of the membrane. And there's only one way they can get back into the mitochondrial matrix, and that is through this protein called ATP synthase. And ATP synthase has binding sites on itself, and what happens is phosphate binds to ATP synthase and ATP binds to ATP synthase. And as hydrogen moves through ATP synthase, the ATP synthase literally spins. And with this spinning caused by the hydrogen rushing through it, energy is sort of released into things that are bound with the ATP synthase, into the phosphate ADP, and they are able to combine to make ATP. And the electrons from NADH have enough energy to create 3 ATP under ideal conditions, and the energy from NADH2 creates 2 ATP under ideal conditions. So what happens is these electrons go through the electron transport chain, hydrogen is pumped, and then hydrogen is, comes back down through the electrical gradient, causes the ATP synthase to spin, and for the spinning we have 3 or 2 ATP made. However, it's a pretty inefficient process. I mean, if you think about it, we're using more energy from forcing the electrons to move from place to place than actually generating, than actually using the energy to generate ATP, and so 60% of it roundabout is lost as heat. Just a quick drawing in case medical school was too long ago. The mitochondrion is embedded in the cell, and inside of it is a matrix, and there's an inner mitochondrial membrane, an outer mitochondrial membrane, and there's an intermembrane space. And the next slide, we're going to zoom in on this inner mitochondrial membrane and have a direct look. At the electron transport chain. Okay, so as I mentioned, we zoomed in. This is our inner mitochondrial membrane. On this side we have our intermembrane space. On this side we have our matrix. And here we have our electron transport chain. And in our electron transport chain we have 4 cytochromes. Now one thing I want you to bear in mind, that this is the best described electron transport chain, and is considered to be the main method whereby most human beings make their ATP through electron transport. But alternative pathways have been described, so there are other ways of using electrons to make ATP besides this sort of 4-step electron transport chain. As I said, this is the main one, so we're going to focus just on this one. On this end, we have ATP synthase, which has a sort of protein bridge whereby hydrogen ions can move from the intermembrane space into the matrix, and this causes spinning of a core part of this molecule, which synthesizes our ATP. It's what that literally basically crushes ADP and organic phosphate together. We start with our NADH++, and they've accepted electrons from our nutrients, and now they need to donate the electrons to the electron transport chain, so they donate 2 electrons, and they go back to being NAD plus. Some hydrogen, these 2 hydrogens plus 2 other hydrogens are pumped through cytochrome 1, so there's 4 hydrogens plopped on this side, due to this process of electrons moving through cytochrome 1. So these 2 electrons are taken up by our ferric component in your cytochrome. So cytochrome is iron with protein. So this ferric becomes ferrous. It accepts the 2 electrons, and then it donates immediately the electrons to coenzyme Q, and then returns back to a ferric state. Coenzyme Q is also referred to as ubiquinone. Coenzyme Q also shares, well, it's manufactured by our body using many of the same steps made to make cholesterol. And statin therapy seems to reduce your levels of coenzyme Q by knocking in the synthesis of cholesterol, apparently also block the synthesis of coenzyme Q, and that may account why patients on chronic statin therapy tend to complain of muscle cramps. Anyway, coenzyme Q, or ubiquinone as also called, accepted 2 electrons, and then will flow through this mitochondrial membrane. Please ignore cytochrome 2 for now. It floats through this membrane and bumps into cytochrome 3 and donates electrons to the iron ion. And this iron ion will immediately then donate the electrons to cytochrome C. And in the process of electrons moving through cytochrome 3, the 4 hydrogens are sucked in from the matrix into the intermembrane space. Cytochrome C then drifts across to cytochrome 4, where it gives off the 2 electrons into cytochrome 4. Oxygen is present and is present in cytochrome 4. Each molecule of oxygen in the O2 molecule will accept 2 electrons, so basically half of an oxygen molecule will accept the 2 electrons that we started off with. And accepted 2 electrons become just an oxygen ion, which then easily sucks in 2 hydrogens to make water. And in the process of electrons being pumped into cytochrome 4 and combined with oxygen, we have 4 hydrogens which are sucked in, but 2 hydrogens are plunked to the oxygen to make water, so in the end we only have 2 hydrogens released into the intermembrane space. So in the end we have 4 plus 4 plus 2, so we have 10 hydrogens in the intermembrane space, and the ideal conditions due just to one molecule of NADH plus H plus. And these 10 hydrogens will then, because of the electrical gradient, this place will be positive, this place will be relatively negative. The hydrogens will be pulled by the electrical gradient through ATP synthase, and in the process, by bumping through the protein molecule, it causes the core to spin and it crushes ATP and phosphate together, and then you have ATP. And we mentioned that each molecule of NADH plus H plus can probably make 3 ATPs. It's thought that there are 3 binding sites. On ATP synthase, I'll say 1, 2, 3, and at each site is an ADP plus a phosphine, organic phosphate, and if you have 10 hydrogens, there's enough sort of electrical gradient to cause this thing to spin so fast that we have 3 ATPs crushed together. Now let's go to cytochrome 2. What happens is that succinate from our Krebs cycle, which we'll go into a bit more detail later, reacts with cytochrome 2 to allow FAD plus 2 hydrogen ions to make FADH2, and they immediately give off the electrons into the ion gives off the electrons into coenzyme Q, ubiquinone, and there are no hydrogens pumped through cytochrome 2. So whatever hydrogens are involved are captured at this step. None of them make it to the intermembrane space. Coenzyme Q goes over to cytochrome 3, gives off the electrons, and now we have hydrogens pumping out. So if we start off at cytochrome 2, or succinate, or with FADH2, we only have 4 plus 2, we only have 6 hydrogens that are pumped into the intermembrane space, of course under ideal conditions. One shouldn't assume that the electron transport chain always operates at 100% efficiency. Chances are energy is lost here and there, and sometimes hydrogens don't get pumped in. But under ideal conditions, FADH2 can get 6 hydrogens pumped into the intermembrane space. And these 6 hydrogens are then pumped, or then sucked through ATP synthase to the electrical gradient, and the energy from these 6 hydrogens is enough to spin the core fast enough to cause 2 ATP to be formed. The core doesn't spin fast enough to get all 3 molecules, but at 2 of the binding sites, these 6 hydrogens will cause ATP form. So FADH2 creates 2 ATP in the electron transport chain. Okay, just to recap then, this is electron transport, and because we're using electrons to combine ADP with phosphate or call this oxidative phosphorylation. And our basic requirements for this one, we're going to need reducing agents, NADH plus H2 or FADH2, and remember that this is these are vitamin B components, so if you're having vitamin B deficiency of either one, we're going to struggle to make these reducing agents, and then our electron transport chain will not work. And remember also, we also need things like coenzyme Q, so we also need a sufficient quantity of enzymes and metabolic machinery. And last of all, we need oxygen, we need an oxidizing agent, we need something that at the end of this electron transport chain can then take the electrons back. Because remember, the electrons also move across the membrane while they're pumping hydrogen, so if we're not sucking those electrons back into the matrix or away from the intermembrane space, we're not going to have that electron gradient forming, because we're going to match our hydrogens with electrons. So this is aerobic cellular respiration. We need oxygen to create that electrical gradient at the last stage, and oxygen is available from breathing, from respiration. So we've discussed oxidative phosphorylation electron transport chain, but we haven't discussed the substrate phosphorylation and also where these hydrogens come from in the first place. What are the methods whereby these hydrogens and electrons are harvested from the nutrients that we eat? And our three sources from which the body can harvest energy, that's carbohydrates, fats, and proteins. And in the process of breaking down carbohydrates, fats, and proteins, we get hydrogens, we get electrons for oxidative phosphorylation. Not only that, but we also make some ATP through enzymes, and that's a process called substrate phosphorylation. So we're going to go through carbohydrates, fats, and proteins, and see how we make ATP from these sources.
Okay, just to recap our study aim, we're going to learn about the derivation of energy. I'm going to start off with carbohydrates, and we're going to look at aerobic and anaerobic conditions, and we're going to look at the metabolic pathways involved in the breakdown of carbohydrates to make ATP. So let's talk about what is a carbohydrate. So we've got carbo for carbon and hydrate for hydrogen. So we've already got some of the answers in the name. But basically, a carbohydrate is a mixture of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, and in a very specific ratio. We've got one carbon atom to two hydrogen atoms for each oxygen atom. And as a generic sort of form, that's carbon H2O. And these carbons can either be in a sort of a chain, or they can be in a ring. Now, simple carbohydrates will have about 3 to 7 carbon atoms. And the most important sugars for human metabolism are usually 5 or 6 carbons long. 5 would be a pentose sugar, and 6 would be a hexose sugar. Okay, so carbohydrates or sugars are divided into sort of subgroups, and the one subgroup is called monosaccharide, and a monosaccharide usually only has one carbon ring or carbon chain, and our 6 carbon long monosaccharides are referred to as hexose, but the more common hexose is glucose, and glucose is also sometimes referred to by its most common form of molecule that is found in, which is dextrose, which just means it's a right-handed version of the glucose molecule. But these terms are often interchangeable: glucose, dextrose, and hexose. Another monosaccharide is fructose, which is more often than not found in its left-handed molecular form, so it's synonym is levulose. Specifically, if you want to be very, very pedantic, levulose speaks about the left-handed version of fructose, but these terms are more or less interchangeable, and classically it's also referred to as a fruit sugar. And fructose has to be converted into glucose in the liver. And then the other monosaccharide is galactose, which is converted into lactose in the mammary glands, covered in glucose via the glycogenic pathway, which we'll have a quick peek at later in this presentation. We have our disaccharides. Disaccharides are two monosaccharide molecules which are plumped together. We have sucrose, stuff that diabetes is made of, I like to think so. But sucrose is glucose plus fructose plumped together to make good old table sugar. And it's the most common dietary disaccharide. We have lactose, which is glucose and galactose plumped together in the milk, and maltose, which is glucose and glucose plumped together. And then our last group is the polysaccharides, which consist of three or more carbohydrates plumped together. And what basically happens is you have hundreds of individual monosaccharide molecules plumped together, and this comes in various forms. It comes in the form of starch or complex carbohydrate, and this we can absorb and digest. It comes in the form of fiber, which is non-absorbable. And the most common form of non-absorbable complex carbohydrate that we have is cellulose. And furthermore, we also have glycogen. Glycogen is also a polysaccharide. We can eat it from mammalian tissue, mammalian livers, but we also synthesize the glycogen in our own muscles and in our own liver. Okay, so carbohydrates form a major component of our metabolic pathways, and that's because they have certain advantages compared to other energy sources. First of all, as an energy store, they are the only energy source that easily makes ATP anaerobically. So through the electron transport chain, once we involve the electron transport chain, we need oxygen. However, with the breakdown of glucose, as we'll see when I discuss the glycolytic pathway, we can actually make ATP in the absence of oxygen through substrated phosphorylation. And during light and moderate exercise, about 50% of our body's energy requirements are actually going to be taken from carbohydrates. And if we need energy breakdown from fat, we need to make ATP from fat molecules. Well, ironically or paradoxically, we need some carbohydrates broken down to provide the metabolic components of fat breakdown. So you can only break down fat in the presence of some carbohydrate breakdown. Furthermore, even in the presence of oxygen, when you're breaking down all these things in the presence of oxygen for aerobic metabolism, aerobic breakdown of carbs is much faster than the aerobic breakdown of proteins and lipids. So through the breakdown of carbs, we actually can create ATP at twice the rate than if we had to break down fat. And there's an enormous amount of energy stored in one mole of glucose. One mole of glucose has 686 kilocalories stored within its chemical structure. Remember, a molecule needs energy to stick together. So if we break down this molecule of glucose, we're going to release energy by splitting all those bonds. And obviously we need oxygen to fully break down this glucose, and break it down, as I mentioned, carbohydrate is carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, with hydrogen being at twice the rate of oxygen. And we break it down, and when we break this down, we make CO2, which usually we can easily breathe out. We're going to have water, and then, theoretically speaking, 686 kilocalories of energy per mole. And if you remember, as I mentioned earlier, the formation of ATP from ADP requires only about 7.4 kilocalories. So in an ideal world that does not have to obey the second law of thermodynamics, we would be able to convert all the 686 kilocalories of energy into 94 moles of ATP. Unfortunately, we have to suffer the consequences of the second law of thermodynamics. Energy does not want to convert into one blob of energy into other blobs of energy. It wants to spread out through the universe, and most of this energy escapes out into the universe and and we only harvest a small amount, which I'll mention in the next slide. Okay, so as I mentioned, energy wants to escape. That's the signal of thermodynamics. That's something we can do about. That's the way God made the universe. And when we are breaking down glucose, most of the energy escapes, and we can only capture a limited amount of that energy. In fact, we only capture about 263 kilocalories out of the 600 plus kilocalories available in glucose, and the rest is released as heat. And we have adapted somewhat to use that heat to regulate our body temperature, but still it's quite an inefficient process, which means that under ideal conditions, when we break down a molecule of glucose, a mole of glucose, we're only going to get 36 mole of ATP out of this potential 94.